We want to integrate a function from 1 to 3, x squared minus 3 dx. So you know that in the Riemann sum notation, this will be the limit as n approaches infinity from the first to the nth, okay, fxi times delta x. Now let's understand, f of xi is going to be xi squared minus 3, right? Because x squared minus 3 is fx. Now, we have to find what delta x is. So, when you're doing Riemann summation, the Riemann sum, you're talking about rectangles. Okay, so if we draw one such rectangle, the width will be delta x, and the length is going to be the function value, which is f of xi. So it makes sense that you're talking about the area formula here. Okay, so f of xi times delta x is equal to area. So, and this is f of xi. So now, we have to, in order to use the Riemann sum, we have to have the i's and n's only. Okay? Because we're dealing with the first I to the nth I. Okay? So, let's find what delta x is. Delta x is going to be found by using n subintervals. Okay? So, if you plot this in the xy plane, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, okay? If you plot this, you will have, let's see, when x is equal to 1, we're going to have negative 2, when x is equal to 2, we're going to have 1, when x is equal to 3, we're going to have 9 minus 3, which is 6, right? So the area is under this curve. Okay, so I'm going to trace the vertical lines here, and then you'll be able to see the area that we're going to determine, okay? The combined area of these shaded regions, and area under the curve, precisely. So, and if we divide this into rectangles, we're going to have basically this, okay? And so on and so on. And these rectangles must be of equal width. Okay, so now thinking of the width of each rectangle, well, first we have to express the let's actually express the delta x. So the delta x is going to be the width of each rectangle, obviously, as we noted before. And since the width of all rectangles must be the same, we're going to take the upper limit, subtract the lower limit, right, because we started at x is equal to 1 and we end up at x is equal to 3, and divide this difference by n. And notice that you're dividing evenly, and that way you will have the same width for all rectangles, and that's going to be 2 divided by n. Okay, so the delta x is equal to 2 divided by n. Now, we have to find the function of xi, okay? The length of each rectangle, basically. We're going to sum up all the areas using the length and found width for all rectangles together. And notice that n is an arbitrary number because we don't know what n is. N can be 10, n can be 20, n can be 30. And the larger the n is, the more precise your area is going to be. So, the less you're going to come out of this shaded region with the extra space, that is. Okay, so we found the delta x. Now, what is xi? So in order to find xi, we have to start from the x subscript 0. And that's going to be 1, the lower limit of integration. X is equal to x subscript 1 is going to be 1. Well, let me say x subscript 0 plus the width. The width is going to be 2 divided by n. Well, I could just say delta x, so that you can see everything in terms of x. And that's going to be 1, because f subscript 0 is 1, plus 2 divided by n. There you go. So now, x subscript 2, the next point. So notice that I'm talking about the vertices of these rectangles. Okay? The leftmost vertex of the first rectangle is 1. The leftmost vertex of the second one is 1 plus 2 over n. Right? The leftmost vertex of the third rectangle is going to be 1 plus 2 over n plus, well, let me say it like this, x subscript 1 plus 2 over n, just the same way, and that's going to be equal to 1 plus 2 over n plus 2 over n. And that is equal to 1 plus 2 plus 2 divided by n is the same thing as 2 times 2 divided by n, okay? So it makes sense that the xi, subscript I, is going to be 1 plus 2i over n. And how do I know that? Notice that the x subscript 2 here matches the 2 here. So that means this I matches this I as well. Okay? So now we've found the formula for the xi, which is 1 plus 2i over n. So I'm going to circle that because we're going to use that information as well. So the function, the f of xi, is going to be xi squared minus 3. So that means this thing will be squared 1 plus 2i over 3, sorry, over n, squared plus, minus 3, right? Minus 3. And this serves as the length of each rectangle. Okay? And the width is going to be, of course, 2 divided by n. Okay, so I can indicate this for you so that you can see these are the components for the area. Okay, this is going to be, let me indicate this in red. This is going to be the width, and this is going to be length. Okay? So now, if you want to combine all of these areas, you will take the width so small. And how do I know that it's going to be small? If you take the limit to infinity for the n, notice that 2 over n will approach 0, because 2 divided by infinity is 0. So basically, you're making these rectangles so small, you're also increasing the number of these rectangles, obviously. And then that means that this overlapped area there, that's kind of overcounting the area, is going to be less and less, right? So you will overcount less and less as you increase the number of rectangles, right? So we're going to take the n to infinity from the first rectangle to the nth, and we don't know what the n is because n is infinity now. F of xi delta x. Now f of xi, as we found, was this. 1 plus 2i over n squared minus 3. And then times the delta x, which is 2 divided by n. So now notice that everything is in terms of I and n now, as we precisely want it for the summation here. So now we have to do a lot of work. Well, actually, you know what? I'm going to get rid of the limit sign because we don't need it. We need to find the area first in terms of n and I, the simplified version. Then we're going to take the limit to infinity. Right, so we're just going to do, let's simplify this. So it's going to be, let's take the 2 over n outside from the I to n. So we're going to have 1 minus 3. So what's 1 minus 3? 1 minus 3 is going to be negative 2. And then let's use the FOIL method for the remaining terms here. 2i over n, so that's plus 4i over n. And then this is going to be plus 4i squared over n squared, right? And this whole thing multiplies the 2 over n. Let's keep simplifying. So that's going to be negative 4 over n. Let's actually break this up into a multitude of several terms involving the summation. So it's going to be plus 8 over n I, right? And then, so I'm going to separate this because this is a case where the n is equal to infinity. So I'm going to keep working here, and then I'm going to have finally plus 8 over n to the third, I believe. Oh, by the way, this should be squared, right? Because n multiplies the n, and the third one gives you n to the third, right? And that's going to be from the first to the nth, and I squared. Now, this is a familiar form now. You see, the reason I separated that is because we're going to have a different term to the right of the summation sign. We're going to have 1, then we're going to have I, then we're going to have I squared. And these will have separate formulas involving the n. So negative 4 over n, notice that when you have 1 multiplying the summation, the answer is basically n. Because if you, let's say, if you combine from 1 to 5, the 1's here, you will do 1 plus 1 plus 1 plus 1 plus 1, that's going to give you 5. So logically, from I to n, if n replaces the 5, you're going to have n as the answer. Okay? It's basically this is basically the rule for that, for having the 1 as the coefficient. So now the next term is going to be plus 8 over n squared. And then here, when you have the I to the right, the formula that you should know is going to be n times n plus 1 divided by 2. Right? And then finally, the last term, plus 8 over n to the third. And I squared, the formula for that is going to be n times n plus 1 times 2n plus 1 over 6, I believe. Yes, that's it. Okay, let me actually make this a little better. Okay, and then as a result, we're going to have negative 4, right? Because the n's here cancel out. Right, n's here cancel out, n here cancels out, the square goes away, 2 cancels out, this becomes a 4. So we're going to have plus 4n plus 4 divided by n. And then for the last one, we're going to have this a little bit more complicated. 6 becomes a 3, 8 becomes a 4, n goes away, n becomes a squared here. Right, so as a result, let's see what happens. Plus 4 over 3, and then this becomes, well, 3n squared, right? 3n squared, and then this becomes, let's see, 2n squared plus 3n plus 1, right? So then we have negative 4, and this becomes plus 4, plus 4 over n. And then let's see, the n squared goes away for the first term, that's going to be plus 8 over 3. And then we have, well, the 3's go away, so that's going to be plus 4 over n. And then finally, the last term is going to be plus 4 over 3n squared. So now, let's simplify this. This goes away. 4 over n combined, so that's going to be, let's see, 8 over 3 plus 8 over n plus 4 over 3n squared. So now we're ready to take this to infinity, because we know that the exact area will be determined when n approaches infinity, when we don't know what the n is, it's infinitely big. So the limit for this fxi times delta x is going to be what we found. Okay, and that's going to be 8 over 3 plus 8 over n plus 4 over 3n squared. So now if you substitute the n with the infinity, because this is what you got to do now, because this is as simplified as it gets, you will get 8 over 3 plus 8 over infinity is 0, right? Plus 4 divided by infinity, right? Because n is substituted with infinity, that gives you 0. So guess what happens? 8 over 3 is your exact area. And that's what you would have gotten using the definite integral, using the first fundamental theorem of calculus. So you can do that for your own practice and confirm that the result is going to be 8 over 3. Thank you so much for watching this video. Please subscribe to my channel, and I'll see you in my next one.